how does, you know, the intervention from Rangde really help the community?
Okay, thank you very much for inviting me to this forum. I'm truly grateful and feeling privileged. I work for Action for Social Advancement. You already have introduced me, my organization, and the collaboration that we had with the Rangde was very timely and I would say very useful. I mean, we are truly grateful to Rangde for the timely help. Let me explain what exactly it was, the content of it. It was the immediately after lockdown, I'm talking about sometime around the beginning of April, and the farmers were distress selling their wheat harvest, and we wanted to intervene. Our producer companies, basically, they in a normal time they procure from their farmers and then immediately sell it to the market, but since the supply chain was disrupted and the producer companies were not very comfortable that entering into procurement of wheat, we requested Rangde to chip in with this interest free loan, because what we calculate is we found that there is still a very small window where FPOs can intervene and procure from the farmers and store it for a while. And at that point in time, we were thinking that, the market will be all right by around Diwali time. So we thought that this is a kind of a 6 to 8 months kind of period. If the FPOs can procure, probably they'll be able to sell it at a reasonably good price around that time, Diwali. But our calculation was not very favorable because the interest cost was, and the storage cost, interest cost, all coming together. It was kind of not a very viable proposition for the FPO to intervene. So at that point in time, Rangde coming to the FPO with interest-free loan proposal was really, really great. And we took that opportunity. Our FPOs and the farmers, they had an agreement that they will place the material to the FPO, and the farmers will connect with Rangde for the loan. And that's how the model was weaved. And it was about 75, 76 lakhs rupees of loan that some 600 odd farmers they took. I think 4 or 5 FPOs participated. And ASHA provided all technical support for the quality control, etc. And we also came out with ASHA also at this thought that, there could be a kind of a price fluctuation risk when the FPOs they sell in the market. So ASHA also created a risk hedging fund, price risk hedging fund, just to, protect them from any kind of disaster if that happens towards the end. Just to cut the story short, so farmers were given a kind of a reasonably good price. So they were protected from distress selling. The previous last year's price was used as a benchmark price, so that was offered to the farmers, and the farmers were saved. So they got their money, they placed their material in the FPO warehouse, and FPO took care of the material for the 6, 7, 8 months. What happened? Our calculation was wrong. Around Diwali, the wheat price was pretty low. It was still selling lower than the purchase price. 14, 15 rupees. That was the kind of price that was the market price at that point in time. Because lockdown has made a such a great impact on the demand side that the price was not showing up. And government was still pushing a lot of wheat through the PDS system. So there was not really much of a demand. So we had to wait. We had to wait till, you know, December. We just about 15, 20 days ago, we could dispose of the entire commodity. And the price that we anticipated, we still didn't get that price. And today, when we do the final calculation, the spreadsheet tells us, if we had not got that interest-free loan, probably the FPOs would have made a loss. So that's what the whole story is, that, you know, how important that interest-free loan was. I just wanted to give this story to tell you that it was an extremely important, intervention. Had that not been done, that 500-600 farmers, they would have probably lost their entire year's income. And then these 4-5 FPOs probably wouldn't have done any kind of business. At the end of the day, I think we managed well. It was not a profit, but nobody also incurred a loss. So that's the story. Now, just to tell you about the bigger piece of the story, is that the rural India has a huge appetite for the loan, right? And all said and done, only 42%, 43% of the people are institutionally connected for loan, right? And the bank loans are not easy to be accessed for those who are not so familiar with the procedural part. It takes time. The easy access loans are extremely expensive, 30%, 35%. You know, I mean, that's the kind of rate of interest. And the farmers really don't have much of a savings, you know. I mean, so the asset creation in the rural areas is not having, just because the access to credit is not that easy. So as a result of it, I'm not saying that the interest-free loan is a sustainable practice. Probably no. Yes, not. It is not going to happen. But a cheaper credit is basically need of the hour in the rural areas, especially to create asset. Unless we create asset in the rural areas, we won't be able to, you know, make a significant dent in the rural economy. And for that asset creation, we need the cheaper credit. That's the point I wanted to bring home. And the experiment that Rangde is doing is excellent. And I think what is great in your model is that you are trying to make people aware about the rural areas and the plight in which they live, and that's probably is the best part of it. If the middle class or those who have money, if they think that, you know, there is a better place to invest their money, I think that's then it will open up a big opportunity. Yeah, thank you very much for this.